Hello everyone, welcome back to Chemical Engineering channel. Thank you so much for your support in the first video and I'm looking forward to your support in the upcoming videos. So in the lecture series of chemical process industries, we are bringing the lecture number 2 and that is focused on the sulfuric acid industry. So we will talk about the production methodology of sulfuric acid today in detail in this lecture. So please do subscribe the channel if you haven't subscribed yet and please watch the video till the end to get the complete knowledge about the sulfuric acid industry. First we will look at the properties of the sulfuric acid. It is obviously called as the king of the chemicals and the economy of any country is dependent obviously on the production of sulfuric acid. It's an important widely used strong dye basic acid with clear and colorless appearance, soluble in water and acts as strong oxidizing and dehydrating agent. Its concentration usually ranges from 93 to 99% when we are purchasing it commercially or commercially availability. Widely sold in the form of either various solutions of sulfuric acid in water or addition of SO3 in H2SO4, H2S2O7, which is called as oleum. And the melting point of 100% pure sulfuric acid is 10 degrees centigrade with a density of 1.84 gram per cubic centimeter. Now, where we can find its application or the applicability of sulfuric acid. It is used in the production of very important and widely used chemicals like fertilizers, metal sulfates, nitric acid, phosphoric acid, HCl. Also, it is widely used in the production of explosive materials like TNT, trinitrotoluene, nitrocellulose, used in the purification of petroleum, a major use in the production of dyes, used for the extraction of copper and uranium from ores, and it serves as an electrolyte in lead acid batteries. So these are the properties and benefits or applications of sulfuric acid worldwide. And now we will move towards the processes that have been used to produce sulfuric acid. Obviously, there are two types of processes, contact process and lead chamber process. Lead chamber process is obviously an old process and not preferred in comparison to the contact process because of various disadvantages or drawbacks. The contact process was discovered by Phillips, an Englishman, in 1831. A mixture of SO2 and air is passed over a catalyst, followed by the absorption of SO3 in 98.5 to 99% sulfuric acid. So this is the overall brief description of the sulfuric acid production using the contact process, and obviously we will be discussing contact process in detail now. Now, the raw materials which are used for the sulfuric acid production, number one is the sulfur, which can be obtained in pure form from ores via mining and can also be obtained from the fuel gases. And number two, the air. And obviously, the purified air is taken in the system. It is dried. Obviously, the procedure, I will explain it later. Used as a source of oxygen for the conversion of sulfur to SO2 and then catalytic conversion of SO2 to SO3. And then sulfuric acid is formed and or oleum is formed in the system. And the catalyst which is used for the production of sulfuric acid is vanadium pentoxide. Now, there are a total of 8 steps, or I can say the overall production process is divided into 8 major steps which are required to produce high purity sulfuric acid or the commercial availability. Number 1 is the melting of sulfur. Number 2 is the drying of air. Number 3, burning of sulfur in the sulfur burner. Number 4 is the heat recovery. Waste heat boiler will be used here. Number 5 is the converter, 4-pass converter for the conversion of SO2. Number 6 is the economizer again for the purpose of heat recovery. Number 7 is oleum production. And finally, sulfuric acid is produced in the system. So now I will show you the overall PFD process flow diagram of this process. But before going there, let's have a look at the chemical reactions. Sulfur reacts with oxygen to produce SO2. This SO2 then reacts with oxygen to form SO3, sulfur trioxide. Then sulfur trioxide reacts with sulfuric acid to form oleum, which is H2S2O7. Sulfur trioxide reacts with water to form sulfuric acid. And the produced oleum reacts with water to form sulfuric acid. The oleum is a byproduct in this system as well. So this is the overall diagram for the production of sulfuric acid. And we will start the process from here, where the sulfur is fed to the melter settler, where steam is also provided. And then this molten sulfur is supplied here to the sulfur burner. Now, if we talk about what is going on in the smelter settler, that it's a concrete tank with steam coils and mechanical agitator to reduce the melting time. And the steam which is provided in this smelter is at a pressure of 50 to 70 psi. The molten sulfur is then transferred to the settling tank because it is a melter settler. So first it is melted, then it is settled down for a time of 72 hours, obviously 3 days, in order to remove insoluble sulfur sludge. And the temperature which is maintained here is in the range of 134 to 140 degrees centigrade. And then it is transferred from the settling tank to the sulfur burner by means of centrifugal pump. And the transfer line is steam jacketed to maintain the pressure. So we are basically talking about here that sulfur first melted, settled down, a certain temperature is maintained. Then it is supplied to the sulfur burner and this line is steam traced. Once the sulfur is provided to the sulfur burner, obviously we need to provide the second raw material, which is the air. And if you can see, first the air passed through the silencer filter, then goes to this turbo blower, and then goes to this drying tower. And from this drying tower, if you can see, the air is supplied to various systems, like it is provided to the sulfur burner from here, it is provided to this heat exchanger here as well, and it is provided to the four pass converter as well. Now, what is going on in this drying tower? We have to first look at it. Air is dried to remove moisture in order to prevent corrosion and formation. Obviously, it is the basic requirement because the moisture in air causes problems in various instances. A turbo blower is used to blow the air into drying tower, and 93 to 98% sulfuric acid is sprayed for dehydration. You can see there is a dotted line which is coming from here in the drying tower, and that is the sulfuric acid, which is the produced sulfuric acid for the process, because for dehydration, for removal of water, sulfuric acid plays a vital role in this drying tower as well. Drying tower is fabricated with steel and is lined with acid proof bricks with ceramic rings. Obviously, this is the material of construction inside the drying tower. The moisture free air is then heated via heat exchanger and then enter the sulfur burner. So what happens here? Air is going into this drying tower, coming out of it, part of it is sent here. However, if you can see this junction over here, it's a type of a mixer, and the fresh air which is coming from the drying tower and that one which is coming from the heat exchanger, if you can look at here, that is the coming out of the heat exchanger, both are mixed and then sent to this sulfur burner. Now in this sulfur burner, you can say the burning of sulfur takes place here, which is the third step in the number. Obviously, we have seen the melting of sulfur, we have seen the drying of air, and now the sulfur will be burned in the process. So in the burning of sulfur, sulfur burner consists of steel vessels lined with fire bricks and insulation bricks or a reflective material to avoid the leakage of heat or the loss of heat in the process. Molten sulfur is injected into the burner along with the air and is converted to sulfur dioxide. Obviously, we know the reaction that the sulfur reacts with oxygen to form sulfur dioxide, and the product gas consists of about 10 to 12% of sulfur dioxide, and temperature varies from 1000 to 1200 degrees centigrade. So once the sulfur is burned, it is then sent to this heat recovery unit because it is at higher temperature, and that high temperature is not favorable to cause the reaction. So here the waste heat boiler and then the hot gas filtration, these are our number four step, which is the heat recovery in the system. And you can see the water will be entered from here and the steam will be produced in the system. Now from where water is coming, we will hold on for few moments. So oxidation of SO2 upon the catalyst layer is not possible at such a high temperature. Obviously, the temperature which is coming from the sulfur burner or the steam coming is at 1000 to 1200 degrees centigrade. So its temperature is let down to 420 to 440 degrees centigrade. And as a result, this other heat exchange media is water. So that is converted to the steam. Gas is filtered once again in order to remove any traces of dust and ash via hot gas filter. And this filter system consists of insulated steel vessel with crushed fire bricks as the filter medium. So basically, we are talking about this filter because the filtration is necessary from here to avoid any traces or any impurities going to this four pass converter. From that filter, the media is then sent to the four pass converter. And if you can see in this four pass converter, air is fed in the second in the third stage as well. These are the 1, 2, 3 and 4. And if you can see from the first pass, the material is coming out from this 4-pass converter, exchanging heat in this heat exchanger and re-entering the stage number 2. And now, or I can say at the exit of 1 and at the entrance of 2, and as a result of this heat exchange, the air which was coming initially from here is then exchanges heat, and you can see now that air mixes with the inlet air which is going to the sulfur burner. So the converter consists of single insulated vessel which consists of 4 layers of catalyst supported upon cast iron grids, and the reaction between SO2 and oxygen is exothermic in nature. The gas enters the first layer at a temperature of 405 to 415 degrees centigrade and leaves at 595 to 605 degrees centigrade. And the reaction which takes place in this first zone is SO2 reacts with half mole of oxygen to form SO3, and 70% conversion is achieved here. However, due to the exothermic nature of the reaction, the temperature rises and we have to reduce this temperature. So what we need to do, the gas is then removed from the converter, cooled to 430 to 435 degrees centigrade, and then re-enters the second layer of the catalyst. And the final conversion which is obtained is 98% in the remaining 3 layers of SO2 to SO3. So as we can see, this is our 5th part of study, and now we are moving to the economizer, and the stream which is coming out of it is sent to the economizer, and in this economizer the feed water is applied, and then the hot water is sent to this boiler, which is a waste heat recovery boiler. So I was telling you that we have to hold on for it, that from where that water is coming, obviously the feed water is going to this economizer, exchanges heat, becomes hot water, and then this hot water is supplied here. So obviously that increases the overall system efficiency in the process. Now once it is going to the economizer, the gas from converter is passed through the economizer and cooled to a temperature of 105 to 235 degrees centigrade. The hot water from economizer is fed to the waste heat boiler. So now you can see we have discussed the heat recovery in the system, the SO2 converter using 4-pass converter, and the economizer. And these two, heat recovery and economizer, are placed to remove the usable heat which can be extracted and used in the process instead of supplying any other utility in the system. Now the last two processes in the production process are oleum production and final step of sulfuric acid production. So what happens is that this gas is then sent to this oleum tower, as you can see from here, and this oleum tower is divided into 2 segments. This is segment number 1 and this is segment number 2. Obviously the pure gas is then sent to the absorption tower, but if you can look at the other aspects which are the dotted line in the system, that this is the number 1 dotted line in the process and this is the number 2 dotted line in the process. This is the oleum which is recycled in the system, and why it is recycled we will discuss it shortly, and this is the absorbing acid cooler which is provided here as well. So oleum is an intermediate product in the sulfuric acid manufacturing process. It consists of 2 parts, top portion where the distribution of oleum occurs, and the bottom part used to circulate 20% oleum continuously. The strength of oleum obtained is usually 38%. Oleum is taken out from the system continuously, cooled down, stored in the steel tanks. So as you can see, the gas is going to the absorption tower. The oleum which is coming from here, if you can see this dotted line, that it is going to this oleum pump. Then this oleum cooler, part of it is obviously going to the storage tank, or majority of part going to the storage tank, while the remaining portion or 20% of it is recycled in the process. Then this final part, which is the absorption tower or the final step of production, that this gas is going to the absorption tower. The exit gas tank, which contains some impurities in the process of SO3 or SO2 traces, is leaving from here. If we talk about here in the process, that the sulfuric acid is coming out. Now the sulfuric acid is going to this circulating tank, and this from the circulating tank it is divided into 2 segments. One of it is recycled, and you can see this is the absorbing acid cooler. It is recycled back to this absorption tower, while the majority of it is going to the storage tank. However, if you remember our air drying system, that part of this sulfuric acid is fed to this air drying tower for the dehydration purposes. So if we look at the theory, the gas leaving the oleum tower contains unabsorbed SO3, and it is passed through the 98% acid absorption tower. This tower is similar in construction to the drying tower. 98% acid tank is common for both for drying air and for absorption tower. 98 to 99% pure sulfuric acid is collected at the bottom of the tower and taken to the storage via the outlet of drying acid cooler at a temperature of 40 to 50 degrees centigrade, and the exhaust gases might contain traces of SO2 and SO3. So our overall process of sulfuric acid is completed here. I can just briefly summarize it. First, the sulfur is melted and settled down here and then is sent to the sulfur burner. The air, which is used as a second raw material, is dried and is split into various parts. But the air is fed to the sulfur burner by mixing with the air which is coming from this heat exchanger. So obviously, in case rising the temperature of the air which is required for this sulfur burning, then due to the high temperature in the process, its temperature is lower down in the process, and as a result the steam is produced and then is filtered to ensure that no dust particles, no traces are going in the 4-pass converter. And then the gas is sent to this 4-pass converter, where conversion takes place. In the first pass, it is 70%. Due to the exothermic nature of the process, the temperature rises, which is again cooled down by this heat exchanger. And by the end of it, 98 to 99% conversion takes place. Then it is sent to the economizer, where further temperature is lowered down. And then it is sent to the oleum tower, which is again divided into two segments. From the bottom of this tank, oleum is coming, which is pumped, and 20% of it is pumped back to the system, while majority of it is went to the storage tank. The gas from the system is sent to the absorption tower and we get the sulfuric acid in the system. And obviously, if you see, the sulfuric acid is going to the circulating tank, and in the circulating tank again it is split into two parts. Part of it is recycled in the process, while majority of it is passing through the drying acid cooler, cooling down to a temperature of 40 to 50 degrees centigrade, and then is sent to the storage. And again, part of it or minor part of it is sent to the drying tower initially for the dehydration purposes. So that's the overall description of the sulfuric acid in the process and how sulfuric acid is produced industrially or commercially available using the contact process. So that's it from this lecture. Thank you so much. Please do watch, like and share the video and subscribe to the channel, Chemical Engineering channel. Till then, it's goodbye. Stay tuned for the next lecture on chemical process industries.